Now, sipping cappuccino in Santa Barbara in September of 2000, I can't complain about the life I'm enjoying right here for the moment, but this is not my home. Behind me are a half dozen motorcycles, including this Ducati, and I'd like to ride off in it, or the Ferrari in the driveway, or the boat behind the camera here. But for the moment, I'm happy with just the cappuccino and a moment with Bob Sinclair. Bob, hello to you. Congratulations again on being Car Guy of the Year in 1996. It's been a couple of years.
Thanks a bunch, Steve. You know, about all the toys, my motto during my career, when I was gainfully employed, which ended coming up on 9 years ago, my motto was work hard, play hard, stay out of jail. And
have a seat while I take to the sky. Take to the sky.
Departure day for SOC 02. Bob Sinclair just rolled in from Santa Barbara. He spent the night in Georgetown, Colorado, and he just arrived at my house here about 8:15, and with quite a cargo. So he's going to show it to Jim, my son-in-law, who's quite interested in motorcycles.
It's fun to fire up and go rah, 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 around to Santa Barbara.
All right.
Gentleman working on his pleasure boat is Bob Sinclair. On work days, Bob heads up an automobile distributorship. But on Saturdays and Sundays, Bob races the smallest offshore powerboat competing in the United States. At speeds up to 60 miles an hour, we think Bob qualifies as a thrill seeker.
Bob and co-driver navigator Oki Gustafson arrived at Marina Del Rey in California early on the morning of the race.
Probably the most significant thing about the boat we're running is that it's without any doubt the smallest boat currently being raced in offshore racing in the United States. It's powered by a 165 horsepower Volvo engine. I think the smallest engine we were up against was three times the size of ours. There are a few plywood bulkheads. It has fiberglass construction throughout, totally. Just a beautiful boat. Offshore boat racing gives me a chance to get out there and sharpen my reactions. Physical reactions, mental reactions. It gives me the motivation to keep my body in good shape. I have lots of competition in the business world, but this gives me an opportunity to go out there and really go nose to nose on the 50-yard line, as they say. The big glory goes to the fellas in the big boats with the big money, I guess, but I sort of think the big fun goes to the guys in the little boats who are sort of out there rubbing elbows with them. The smallest engine class for offshore is 0 to 300 cubic inches, and the largest goes up to 1,000 cubic inches, and those are the big twin-engine 36-foot cigarettes.
But I think when the fog is gone like this, it's got to be a little bumpy because the wind is blowing the fog off.
Yeah, right.
And especially on the
backside of the island,
I think
right. We're
going to find it a little rough.
I think the biggest problem, as far as endurance is concerned, is the jiggling your innards get, and I wear the bottom half of a wetsuit plus a motorcycle kidney belt. Of course, if you have a failure, such as the steering giving way or something like that, the boat can broach, banging against whatever you run up against, and fellas do get broken arms and legs and ribs and things like that.
Bob's heading for the starting line. his boat is the smallest in the race. The pace boat has them lined up. There's the running start.
The start of the race is a pretty critical moment because everyone's charging. They want to be right up there in the line.
Bob's boat has won its class in every race he's entered. Look at him go.
The pounding is pretty horrendous. I've been involved in some pretty rough sports, off-road racing, motorcycle riding, and some pretty hairy activities, and I've never been in one that was as rough as this. It's really an incredible pounding.
Bob Sinclair, offshore boat racer and thrill seeker.
Waitress, I need two more boat drinks. Then I'm heading south for my drain shrink. I gotta go where it's warm. I gotta go where it's warm.
The reason that you're stuck with me here tonight is that Sinclair just about burned down the Los Angeles Automobile Show trying to find somebody else. And ran into me at the last minute and said, hey, would you come to Cincinnati? And I'll go anywhere. So I said, sure. And you're paying the price. Sinclair evidently has some kind of grudge against you guys. He also has a very strange sense of humor. I wondered, does anybody in Sweden know that you're all here tonight?
Driving my Saab on my way to Ireland. It's been a long time. It's been a long time. Driving with my friends on my way to Ireland. It's been a long time. It's been a
agreement between Saab and GM should be seen as one more step, albeit a giant step, in the continuous 40-year growth and development of Saab, one of the world's most innovative producers of specialized automobiles. Saab launched the turbocharging wave at the beginning of the 80s, a development that has swept the Western automotive world. We developed and introduced the Saab 9000 family, one of the world's truly significant automobiles, with its combination of performance, that I prefer to call fun to drive, along with enormous carrying capacity, comfort, and astonishing safety. Saab has it all. Style, comfort, enormous carrying capacity, safety, performance, and most important of all, to a lot of buyers, it's sheer fun to drive.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed days dog say goodnight, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.